So good evening and welcome. My name is Michelle Davis and I'm a 1987 graduate of the college and I'm honored to serve this year as the Emory Alumni Board President, which is the governing body that represents Emory's 137,000 alumni around the world. I'm so pleased to see so many friends and fellow alums here this evening in this magnificent presidential library in the heart of our city. The library stands in tribute to the power of vision and shared values for the benefit of the world. The common threads between the mission of Emory and the Carter Center run deep and continue to grow. As you know, the Carter Center has, for many decades, contributed to advancing humanity in a myriad of ways. Under President Carter's leadership, the center has made significant impacts on global health through work to eradicate guinea worm and river blindness, work to bring peace through open dialogue on difficult issues, and fostered free and democratic elections all over the world. Similarly, addressing issues like these is interwoven into the fabric of Emory University. Under the guidance and vision of two university presidents we're fortunate enough to have with us tonight, Dr. James Laney and Dr. James Wagner. Through their leadership, the faculty and students of Emory bring research, medical advances, cultural understanding, and academic knowledge around the world, often through shared initiatives of Emory and the Carter Center. Some of you, in fact, may be former Carter Center interns who exemplify the unique partnership between Emory and the Carter Center. We are indeed privileged tonight to witness and participate in a conversation with these esteemed panelists who represent such significance in our local and global story. In a few moments, we will hear how that legacy and connection began and perspectives on where these two global institutions rooted in Atlanta may go in the future. Before I want to introduce them, I do want to remind you to please submit your questions. I know we've got a lot of great questions already, but the staff's going to be passing through one more time. So if you have one of those last minute questions, please add them. Now it gives me great pleasure to introduce our panelists. Moderating our discussion this evening is Emory alumna Crystal Edmondson, Emory College class of 1995 and well-known locally as the broadcast editor for the Atlanta Business Chronicle and a regular contributor on public radio. Joining her on stage is President Jimmy Carter, 39th President of the United States and University Distinguished Professor at Emory, President Emeritus James T. Laney, President of Emory from 1977 to 1993, and Ambassador of South Korea from 1993 to 1997, and President James W. Wagner, Emory's 19th President. Please help me welcome all of our program participants to the stage.
Michelle, thank you so much for that warm welcome, warm introduction. Thank you all for being here this evening. It's a pleasure to be serving as moderator of this panel. Thank you to all of our panelists for being here, Dr. Wagner, President Carter, and Dr. Laney. I make no promises about what's going to be presented tonight, but it's going to be enjoyable and it's going to be great. I can tell you that. For many of you all, if you've been involved with Emory, been involved with the Carter Center, you may feel like, well, they've always sort of been together, but maybe you don't know sort of the history that ties the two organizations together or how they came together. We'll explore that tonight. What are the ties that bind, so to speak, these two organizations and where we go from here? And without further ado, we'll launch right into that conversation. I'd like to begin, President Carter, with you to talk a little bit about, your historic visit to Emory's campus and sort of how you got involved with Emory.
Well, I was president of the United States, and that's why I got invited.
Yeah, I heard that.
And because I was invited by Emory, I decided to come. So it was a groundbreaking for the Cannon Chapel. And I remember it was in August of 1979. And I was given an honorary doctorate. And I was given heavy robes to wear during that August outdoor session. And I commented in my remarks, and I've commented several times since then, about 30 times, that I have never been that hot in a cotton field. So I remember very well that wonderful occasion, and it got me in touch with Bishop Cannon, Billy Cannon, who later played a major role with me and was one of the surest friends I've ever had in my life. So that's when I met Dr. Laney, and so he was the orchestrator of that event.
Well, Dr. Laney, did you imagine that during that groundbreaking that this would forge a deeper relationship with President Carter and that you might someday hire him to be a professor at Emory?
No, none of that. I was just thrilled that we would have a sitting president of the United States visit the campus. And we just wanted President Carter to feel at home, to make it feel like a cotton field or a peanut farm. And as for heavy robes, I can't help but point out that President Carter just got back from England, where he was in the robing room where the Queen dons her ermine regalia for state occasions, to be enormously honored for the Carter Center and its work on guinea worm and its eradication. But I think it's true, and it's like we wanted to do in 1979 when we honored him with an honorary degree. I think they felt this was a person, as well as the Carter Center, who represented for them what was best and humane and noble in life. And that was then, and last week, and it was in 1979. But it was an exciting time, and we look back on it. I must say that the national news, the network news that night, carried a report about its visit to Emory. And Emory at that time wasn't getting a lot of television network time in the prime time. And it quoted part of the citation. It said, President Carter has a piety that is natural and so typical to the South, but so enigmatic to the rest of the nation.
Well, I've had many experiences since then in the Cannon Chapel, and I always think about that day and how it was my first introduction to Emory. That's not exactly right, because my brother Billy was a student at Emory for a while.
That's right.
Well, I won't go into detail.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that.
We won't talk about that, but, you know.
Well, I already got confused between Emory University and Manuel's Tavern. But,
well, 1979, let's fast forward to 1980, a big year for Emory, the year that we received the Woodruff gift, and things had changed quite a bit, or would change moving forward. And President Laney, did you ever think that getting that gift and that the two of you, President Carter, President Laney, would come together and plan even more of the future of Emory?
Well,
later the Carter Center.
Thank you, Crystal. The gift gave us a sense of strength, and it wasn't something that we could just spend, but it gave us a prominence in the nation. It made headlines in the New York Times, all that sort of stuff. But the thing it did was it gave us a scope of greater ambition. And I had always felt that since President Carter was the first president from the Deep South since before the Civil War, and he was from Georgia, that we wanted him, whether it was in 1981 or 1985, when he left the White House, we hoped that he might come back and work with us in tandem with the library, and as it turns out, the center as it evolved. At the time, it was nebulous. I'm sure it was clear in President Carter's mind, but we didn't know. And that was something that we really had in mind. And I ran across the other day a letter from President Carter in December of 1980 that was in response to a letter that I had sent him. This was after the election, and I'd invited him or asked if we could have a discussion about after the White House, you know, when he came back home. And he wrote very, very graciously, and it was that was the beginning of some talks that led to further things, and then so forth. Yeah.
Well, President Wagner, I want to get you in this conversation.
I'm enjoying this. you
don't get a pass on this discussion. How did you come to become familiar with the Carter Center and Emory's relationship with the Carter Center, and when did you first meet President Carter?
Well, we're talking decades after the stories you've just heard, and I'd like to go back and revisit some of those stories. It was 2003. In fact, I met you two folks within about a couple of weeks. It was during the summer of 2003. It was during the time that we were imagining the possibility of coming to Emory. Jim, you and I had a breakfast, and I can tell by the fur of your brow you don't recall a thing about that, but I do. Remember, it's a convergence. These stories actually converge. Remember that, Jim, one of your themes for Emory University during the 16 years that you were president was about the dual responsibility of every university, and Emory in particular, to be educating both the heart as well as the mind. I was unescorted on that one. A couple weeks later, I came to the Carter Center to meet you. Now, they wouldn't let me do that without an escort. Ben Johnson was with me. I've told you that. I've reminded you of this story in the past. And we sat down. Now, you have to know that in March of that year, while they were looking for President Emory, you had made statements, and they had been reflected in op-ed pieces in the AJC and otherwise that, you know, Emory really needed to get its act together, that it had a global service responsibility. They ought to just take about $500 million. That's what you said. But I didn't know that, right? So I'm walking in, or maybe I was told it on the way. And so it didn't take you long. There were very few niceties that I remember before he began saying, you know, Emory has an enormous potential, enormous responsibility to be working in global development and global health. And he said, you need to help me make your trustees understand that. And I'm not, essentially, it was very clear. I don't know if you said it out loud, but I left the room knowing that if I ended up at this job, I was going to hear that incessantly. The result, folks, actually, quite literally, we moved to a strategic plan, immediately began working on a strategic plan that was put in place in 2005, and a keystone of that plan was a global health initiative. The Global Health Institute that now exists, and we can talk more about that if you care to, an Institute for Developing Nations in 2007. By the way, part of his full court press, may I tell this story?
Sure.
Was a trip to Africa. Debbie and I were able to do that. It was 2005, I believe, to sub-Saharan Africa. We went to Mali and Nigeria and Ethiopia, and the Carter Center graciously arranged. By the way, John Hardman was part of that trip as well. He had graciously arranged for me to meet with university heads in each of those, Abadan University, Bamako, and also Addis Ababa University. But I think the real reason was to get to know the Carter Center and its, I'm right, right? You didn't really care about those universities. It is clear that he was right on this one. Emory does have a special opportunity, a special calling. One could argue that in public health generally, and global health in particular, Atlanta is a real crossroads with CDC and with the Task Force for Global Health, with the Carter Center and other partners. And I don't think anybody was terribly surprised inside of Emory when we were called on ultimately to take care of those first couple of patients, the first ever treated in the Western Hemisphere for Ebola virus. And that partnership, that urging on his part, with, as I said, Global Health Institute, Institute for Developing Nations. There was also, we also were one of the very first chosen by MacArthur Foundation to have a Master's of Development Practice. All of these things certainly were consistent with and perhaps driven very strongly by the seed forcefully planted in those conversations. So that's The long answer to your question.
Well, I think if I'm to understand this correctly, the niceties flowed a little more freely as the relationship.
But they have indeed. We have other occasions to.
So, I understand that the three of you are morning people, if we could put it that way, and that you often do meet over breakfast. Tell us a little bit about that practice and why that's important to continue to do.
Well, maybe this audience isn't aware. Remember, President Carter carries this title of University Distinguished Professor that Jim, you...
I want to go back to that in a minute, but that's
okay. And part, and he takes that duty very seriously. So a week each month, the week that he is in Atlanta, there is time reserved for Emory University. I inherited something, I assume, Jim, that you started. Jim, everybody's Jim.
A lot of time.
Yeah. Well, we'd have a breakfast meeting, and Debbie and Mrs. Carter, President Carter, and I, and as well as I saw Gary Hawk here this evening, and John Hardman, and now Marianne Peters. And so we would have this monthly opportunity to engage and develop some niceties, as you say. And that continues. In fact, the most recent breakfast, all three of us were present to talk about this evening. Jim, you were going to say something about his...
Well, I was just thinking the relationship with President Carter really began with that appointment to the faculty, and out of that emerged in successive stages the idea of where to put the library and how the center would be formed and what its purposes were. But I have to say that for 5 years, 4 or 5 years, President Carter had his office on campus at the top of the Woodruff Library. Some of you may remember that. And so he would walk across campus and frequently seen on campus, and it caused, as you can imagine, quite a sensation, trailed by Secret Service and all, and walking across the quadrangle, just a normal scene in Emory University. And one of the early days of that association, President Carter and I were walking across, had just begun walking out of the administration building together and talking, and coming toward us was Professor Carl Deutsch, who had recently come down from Harvard, where he had had one of the most distinguished careers in political science and international relations of anyone in the country, and he was now on our faculty. And so I wanted President Carter to meet Dr. Deutsch, and we stopped, and they had the exchanged greetings and pleasantries. And then a very interesting thing happened. Carl Deutsch took President Carter's hand in both of his hands, and he said, "Mr. President, I want to tell you that in 1,000 years, there won't be a handful of presidents' names remembered, the presidents of the United States, in 1,000 years. That's a long time. But your name will be remembered because you were the first world leader to link human rights with foreign policy." That was a powerful, powerful moment. Do you remember that moment? So those were some of the interchanges that would take place, and it was kind of a natural feeling to have you on campus, and I think that was a wonderful beginning to our relationship.
And it was.
And you continue to lecture regularly, have lunches with select group of faculty.
That's right.
And try to spread those lectures around, right, in different parts.
We try to go to every division once a year, but sometimes we don't make it. But we go, I have political science and history and religion and theology and English and medicine and nursing. And I think business as well. So, and law, I forgot. But I go to all of those every year if I can. Dr. Steve Hockman schedules my visits, and I don't get everybody every year. But also every year, have a town hall meeting with about 4,000 or something students, and they ask me unpredictable questions, and I go there with a lot of trepidation, but I survive pretty much. And then I also have an annual meeting with the international students at Emory. So I have two or three special things that I do every year.
And I just tell this group, the university distinguished professor title, as far as I know, you're the first to have received that title and have set such a standard that while we have had other distinguished members of our faculty, we've never used that title precisely.
He's the only one. President Carter was appointed. He said, "Now, does this carry tenure?"
Good question.
I said, "Well, you know, you to get tenure, you got to write a couple of books." Yeah. So he wrote 24 books.
I still don't have tenure.
Well, now that's a successive generation.
I think I dropped the ball. Well,
President Carter, as you meet with faculty members and various constituencies of Emory University, what are some things that you like to instill or to inspire, or what do you like to contribute to those conversations and hope that people take away from your visits there?
Well, I generally lecture for about 20 minutes and answer questions for at least 30 minutes or so. And the questions give me a good insight on what the students believe and want and hunger for. And I think that one of the things that I try to do is to tie modern day human experiences with the moral and ethical values that never change. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have lived in constantly turbulent times where we have to accommodate changes every day in our life, but there are some things that never change. And I think that Emory, one of the attractions that I had to come to Emory was what Jim Laney explained it wanted to do with the Woodruff's new gift back in those early days, and that was to expand its horizons in an academic world, but also expand its horizons in a moral and ethical foundation for everything that they do. And then what we've added since then, I think, is that Emory is reaching out to foreign countries in a very aggressive way, which Jim Wagner has just described. So I try the students' daily life in a program on English or theology or religion or nursing or medical doctors with what the basic moral values of life might be and what their own profession can be, how they can use their own profession to extol those values as they become an adult and have a career.
Mm-hmm. Which is very useful. And the flip side of that is, as President Carter comes to speak to students and faculty at Emory, how has Emory University's education and curriculum benefited from having him come and speak with the various constituencies?
Well, coming to speak. I was going to say, there are also formal connections. Emory mm-hmm. is, you know, we have a number of students who participate in the internship program, et cetera. And I think in the earlier days, Jim's, there was quite a very active fellows program of faculty
That's right.
exchange yeah. at those times. But, well, you know, it's interesting. I think short answer to your question is we have students and faculty, but students who understand that President Carter is our professor. That's a powerful thing. You don't claim a professor if you don't also claim something of the values. Right. Emory is indeed explicit about its ethical engagement, or at least attempts for ethical engagement. And having him season the campus as he does is a reinforcement of that, I think.
Yeah, in the early days, almost all of our top fellows at the Carter Center were also professors at Emory. Bob Pastor taught full-time over at Emory and also worked at the Carter Center. And Richard Joseph, who was an expert on African-American affairs, did the same thing, and others as well. And this was a great benefit to us because it cemented in the Carter Center's work the academic profession and the knowledge of that area of life and helped with Emory as well. But it soon became clear to everyone, including the presidents of Emory, that couldn't go on permanently because we became so deeply involved in tangible specific affairs in foreign nations that it took too much time away from the classroom. So we've kind of not abandoned that idea, but we've gotten the best out of both worlds, I think.
Mm-hmm. You know, at the same time, we have also incorporated, you know, when John Hardman during the times, at least John, wherever you are, that we were together, we asked John to sit with the deans of the university and dean's council and, you know, other ways that we, you know, work to tighten that up. And an Institute for Developing Nations, when it began in 07 or 08, was intended also to for Emory to spend more time understanding the Carter mission and the opportunities for our faculty to participate in that. And that's a jointly funded activity.
You know, we did the opposite thing, too. One time I came back from overseas, having been gone a long time, and had breakfast with Jim Laney and his wife. And he said, "What, you're an expert on overseas, but why don't you do something at home?"
Oh, that's a good one.
And no, it wasn't quite like that.
That's the way I remember it. That's the way I remember it. But anyway,
I'm going to tell my side in a minute.
We started what was called the Atlanta Project.
Yeah.
And so we decided that we would find the poorest and most destitute people who lived in Atlanta and what the Carter Center and Emory could do for them. So I went down to the Census Bureau and I got a map of the places that had the most single-parent families and the grandmothers who were at the lowest age. And it had a black mark across the southern part of Atlanta. Mm. And I said, okay, that's what we'll adopt for the Atlanta Project. And it turned out to be 500,000 people. Mm. So we divided it eventually into 20 groups of 25,000 each. And eventually, every one of those 25,000 was treated as a separate entity, kind of like a little town. And they were given a key person to represent them. Everyone had a major corporation that adopted them, a bank or a Coca-Cola company and so forth, or Delta Airlines. And then they all those 25 had an individual university that attached itself to them. So those 25,000 people that had previously not known much about the outside world, how to get a grant from the government and things like that, they began to learn about the true values of living in Atlanta. So we organized massive programs to immunize all the children, and we had a good program there and a lot of other things. So we kept that going up until the Olympics took place in 1996, and then we continued on for 4 years, and every one of those 20 groups graduated from our program, except three, and we turned them over to Georgia State University, and they took them on and kept them for about 5 more years. So every one of those people learned a new thing about how their lives could be improved. But they were so poverty-stricken that none of their school teachers lived in the community. None of the teachers, none of the policemen, none of the welfare workers lived in the community. They lived in a nicer part of town and commuted in and out every day. So we changed all that for many people. Now you tell your version.
Well, that's a great version. I was just thinking about that first breakfast. I had been talking with some of our colleagues about trying to do something with the university as a resource, both human and otherwise, in a designated area of Atlanta. And it was formidable to consider, and so it happened that we had breakfast within a day or two after that idea had begun germinating, and I began talking about it, and President Carter very graciously and ambitiously, I'd say, but that was typical of his grasp of everything, said, you know,
my ability to delude people.
Yeah.
I made him think I was fully on board, but I felt a lot of pressure, you know, from my boss. Go ahead.
No pressure. I told you that I just explained that, and you said, you know, that really needs to be done, and would it be all right with the university if I devoted my time in the university, you know, the next year or two to trying to work something out? Now, that's the way it began, but I know it moved. But I wanted to say that one of the first things President Carter did in the Atlanta Project that I recall is to bring together or connect the federal, the state, the county, the local governments, and all the agencies that are working, trying to do things, address these needs. They had no communication. They were all silos. And the Carter, Atlanta project began connecting those so that there could be some synergy and coordination. That would, in itself, was a huge plus to get the power of all these governments together so that the focus could really be productive. That's but I my hat's off to President Carter because it went faster and further and higher than anything I'd ever envisioned.
Well, that's part of the strategy of the Carter Center globally, right? Yeah. To bring those agencies together.
I want to mention, too, Crystal, having President Carter's presence on campus, it's hard to imagine how electrifying it is to have President Carter come to a town hall meeting. You've already mentioned that. Mm-hmm. Just marvelous. And to see a president with that openness and that a grasp of the issues and depth and complexity and the lack of defensiveness and the civility, which is so lacking in modern discourse, it in itself is an example of how we ought to be teaching students. This is what citizenship means. But it also, his presence on campus, meant that we were able to get Bishop Tutu to come as a faculty member and get Shevardnadze, the president of Georgia, to come for commencement and to get Gorbachev. To come, and these were huge occasions for the city and for the whole nation, and they were all out of the access and all that President Carter could bring, and the university just enjoyed that prominence. And it excited the students to be part of something that, you know, that was like that.
I can attest to that. I can remember being on campus as a
you
student
were there.
And thinking, you know, the town hall is tonight, you know, and being excited about that.
Yeah.
So, I can certainly attest, and I'm sure many of the folks in the room feel the same
Still
way.
Still a big event.
Sure, mm-hmm. Sure. Now, just as a reminder, we will be taking some questions from the audience in just a moment. But I would like to ask you, and we've spent a lot of time, we could continue this conversation about how Emory University and the Carter Center forged this relationship decades ago. But I'd like to ask each of you what you hope will be the future of this relationship moving forward. We certainly have seen some fantastic outgrowths of this relationship, but where do we go from here? What would you like to see?
Well, I would say, first of all, I think the partnership is permanent. It's basically indestructible because it means so much to the Carter Center and it means so much to Emory. And both of them together, neither one of them wants to dissolve the process. So I think it's permanent. But I think the thing that we need to do in the future is what we've done in the past, and that is be very flexible in what the official relationship might be. We have a provision, I think, in the bylaws of the Carter Center that we can't dissolve the partnership unless there is a three-quarters vote, two times separated by 6 months apart. So there's almost no way that we'll ever vote to dissolve it, even if we wanted to. Yeah. So I think that we need to be flexible, and when the attention of the combination, the Carter Center and Emory together, needs to be more overseas, let it evolve into more troubled areas, and when it's more domestic problems that are not being resolved adequately by our own government and others, then let us concentrate on that. But I hope we'll be flexible as time continues in the future. That's what I hope. And I might say quickly, I wanted to say while I go in, but I didn't want to interrupt Jim again, but I have personally gotten more out of the partnership than Emory has.
Oh,
there's no doubt about that.
That's nice.
It's made my life since the White House, primarily because of Emory, the best time of my life.
Yeah, thank you, Jimmy.
Oh,
that's
thank
true.
You.
Well, thank you.
Well, I mean it. Yeah, thank you.
Um, There's really not much to add to that. I think the flexibility is key. Emory's worked, and I think the Carter Center broadly has worked hard to populate our board with people who share that commitment. Emory nominees to that board, almost all of them either are or have been members of the board of trustees of Emory University. I mean, that's how, these aren't just courtesy appointments that that one makes. I think flexibility is important also because of, as you said, the world situation changes, the position in Carter Center changes. But Jim, back to Jim Laney's points about the principles, those are the ones that I think, and when you made those same point, actually, it was a point you were making, right? About talking to people in different contexts about exactly the same principles. I think as the world context changes, the principles of the Carter Center will apply nevertheless and need to be pursued. So it's hard to imagine. It'd be interesting, Jim Laney, you've now stood sort of to the side of this partnership for a number of years. Has it moved in the direction you expected it to and would have wanted
it
to?
Well, it's far exceeded anything that certainly I could have envisioned or even dreamed. I mean, you know, the scope and magnitude and the success of its policies and programs was just astonishing. So, you know, I'm one of my happy times was after I came back from Korea and was a trustee of the Carter Center and just would meet and hear the reports, which every time were amazing. So I just hope that the relationship can be not only strong and mutually reinforcing, but also have common programs that are not constraining on the Carter Center or on Emory, but find ground that doesn't exclude other things. It just means common ground, which is true now in many ways. And, you know, it would be hard to overstate the importance of the Carter Center's role in the creation and success of the Rollins School of Public Health at Emory right now.
Well, indeed. And Rollins School of Public Health, nursing, actually law, a lot of work.
But I mean, that began back then, actually, after the Carter Center relationship, Rollins School.
You make an excellent point. Part of the strength of going forward will be that the two institutions are drawn together, not bound together.
Yeah.
There is strength in the independence of the Carter Center. There's strength for Emory independence of the Carter Center and strength for the Carter Center in having the freedom. Actually, this is an easy thing for universities to imagine. The central university is not dictating where the medical school goes or where the... there's a... In a similar way, what makes the Carter Center especially valuable to the university is this sort of, as you say, unconstrained nature of the relationship. So the dependence is a voluntary, eager dependence as opposed to a forced and unnatural interaction. And I know, you and I sat in my office one time and talked very directly about that. That may be why you and I both have memorized that portion of the bylaws that talks about how you separate. and decided it should never and must never and won't ever be used. Fair enough?
I think it's fair. Yeah.
Well, at this time, I'd like to leave some time for questions from the audience. And Michelle is bringing us some of those. Thank you. Okay, so here's a question I'll toss it out there, President Carter, President Laney, President Wagner. Was there ever a time or any thought in the past or even moving forward that the university might offer degrees through the Carter Center or perhaps public policy or international relationships? So any sort of degree program?
Well, it did not... It was not a part of any consideration or discussion that I had during the time that I was in office at Emory. There were other ways that it would enrich it, and I think it would be would be constraining to try to provide the requirements for a degree through the Carter Center.
Yeah, one of the points President Carter made when we were talking about the fellows and how that ran its course is that, remember, the Carter Center is action-oriented, very short, sometimes very short-term action-oriented. This is why having faculty, having students engaged, it enriches the academic program and it exists. But our academic programs have a certain pacing to them. Mm-hmm. World affairs don't necessarily follow the academic calendar. So I think, again, its strength is how it amplifies a student experience. I don't anticipate that there would be degrees based in the Carter Center.
Mm-hmm. So here's a question.
Well, you know, a couple of former fellows come to mind. Our major director that started the Carter Center on its health program was Dr. William Fagge, who had previously been head of the CDC. Mm-hmm. And he later went to the Gates Foundation and came and worked with Emory to establish their global health program. And I'd say Marion Creekmore is another one. He was former ambassador to Sri Lanka. And he went to North Korea with me and Rosalind. And Jim Laney was a South Korean ambassador to South Korea at that time. Mm-hmm. And when he came back to Emory, that entire area of the eastern part of the world was brought into much greater focus on the Emory campus. So I'd say that the relationship has benefited Emory's academic program, but I think it would be a mistake, I agree with both the other gyms, that for them to have a curriculum that would define what the Carter Center does or vice versa would not work. I don't think it would work.
Yeah, I agree.
We've talked a lot about faculty ties from Emory to the Carter Center and so forth. One thing we haven't addressed is the role that Mrs. Carter has played in that relationship as well. And she's here this evening. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, she had a mic. She could do this better herself. Well, you know, I've said hundreds of times, even when Rosen wasn't there, that if the Carter Center hadn't done anything except sponsor Rosen's mental health program around the world, it would all be worthwhile. And that's certainly true. And there are fellows at Emory University who filled Rosen Carter chair in mental health and so forth. So I would say that in those areas, Rosen has played a major role. She's also been a professor there for many years, like I have, and she has dealt there with women's issues. And I think that the Carter Center's later involvement in the deprivation of women and girls of their basic rights around the world is because of her relationship with Emory and feeding back into. So it's been a rich relationship.
Mm-hmm. Emory enjoys an annual lecture on mental health journalism that is named in your honor, owing to your interest in that area. And the other thing is, it's no accident that she is with you when we have our breakfasts. I get both barrels that way. And she's very much involved in all aspects of what the Carter Center is doing, and so we feel that. Yeah.
Well, here's another question. Back to our early discussion of the transformational, transformative gift that came from the Woodruff Foundation back in the 80s. This question asks, if Emory were to get a comparable sized gift today, how would it be used?
I guess I'm the only one that can answer that.
Well, what's different than maybe, you know, then?
Let's talk first about what's the same. What Jim chose to do with that gift was invest in people. And so to this day, we have Woodruff Fellows among our faculty. We have Woodruff Scholars, in fact, among our students. It's the most prestigious of the scholarship opportunities that incoming students can receive. And in fact, we've just grown that owing to additional gifts to that. I will tell you, given where universities are today, it's still the people. to have the a place like Emory takes a great amount of its budget and allocations out of operations in order to ensure that we have access for students. This is another, again, these fellows setting the stage for what the values need to be, in order that we have a broad socioeconomic representation in our student body. We have programs that cap debt. We have programs of family from a family who sends a young person to Emory, who the family making less than $50,000 a year, they graduate with no debt. And $100,000 a year, that's capped at a certain level, $15,000. But a lot of that money, because we're committed to it, a lot of that money comes out of operations. And a big gift that could be used to endow in perpetuity the sort of support we give to people, again, students and faculty, would free up operations in order that it remains to be seen, but Emory is poised, as President Carter alluded to be an even more global, more of a global presence. And with the partnerships that we have, we suspect those global presences will be in developing nations, and developing peoples of developing nations. One of the most recent, just to give you an example, Emory was just awarded in global health a $75 million Gates grant. And actually, it's a 20, nobody gets 20-year grants. It's a 20-year grant, and they have said they will supplement that. But it is, the acronym is CHAMPS, Childhood Health and Mortality Prevention Surveillance. It's a program to go into nations in Africa and, I believe, South America to monitor, to actually get hard data about what is what is killing our global, our children. That's something we wouldn't have been positioned for not very long ago, and we're foolish, in my view, if we don't follow that in a more aggressive and exciting way going forward. So new money to support people in order that, that Emory could expand its reach and programs and effectiveness that I think it's called to do.
Mm-hmm. We have another question. This one is for President Carter. With the Zika virus in the news every day, is there any thought that the Carter Center would take on the virus or other mosquito-borne diseases? And how does the center go about making decisions on which diseases to treat, so to speak?
Well, we were deeply involved in Ebola crisis in Liberia in particular because of reasons I need not go into. We had three programs that came together to really let the government communicate with the people and tell them what should and should not be done about Ebola. And that's why Liberia did so well with it. The Carter Center has the only organization on earth that analyzes every human illness regularly to see which one might be eliminated from one country or one region or eradicated from the entire world. Mm-hmm. And so we have 10 or 12 other partners with us, like the World Health Organization and Gates Foundation and UNICEF and so forth, that work with us on that. And so we are constantly probing for ways to get the World Health Organization to join with us in eradicating diseases. And so I think that as a new disease comes up, we are very close in contact with the Centers for Disease Control and also with the World Health Organization. If they see a need for the Carter Center to concentrate on a particular disease because we are very prominent in that country already with our programs or because we have some special knowledge or experience in that area, then we would do it. But we wouldn't just take on an initiative of our own to go into the Zika virus, and we didn't either for Ebola. So I would say the answer to your question basically is no, this would not be the kind of initiative that Carter would be likely to take. The Carter Center would probably look now for another disease to be eliminated or eradicated. We're already exploring that constantly to see where we go in the future.
Well, thank you. Now this question, and it will probably be one of our last of the evening, but it is for each of you. It says, could you speak, each of you, of a leadership crisis when, if another party could have read your mind, the problem would have been easily resolved immediately. So a leadership crisis that if the other party had just simply read your mind, could have been solved that fast.
I'm trying to narrow it down.
This is, yeah.
To just one. Do you want to go first?
I didn't understand the question.
I think we've run out of time. How about a different?
Sure. I
can't. Maybe, but Jim.
Yeah, but if you're not going to play, I'm not going to do this if you're not going to. Go ahead if you think of something.
Maybe clarify.
Yeah, very, very quickly. I think one of the things we're learning in leadership, or maybe we learn it too late, is that there are certain, it's a good question, because there are certain biases everybody brings to decisions. And I think very specific cases where if you have too few people in the room or only people who agree with you, those biases can lead to unwise decisions. What we know from sociological data are that the biases that we have are almost impossible completely to eradicate. Training to change our biases, to change our gut feelings, we can show that that training is effective, but not durable. Mm-hmm. And there is great and unfortunate literature on that. So if I can't change what my gut tells me, it's wise to bring people in the room with different guts. To me, this is one of the highest and most important purposes for engaging diversity in leadership. You imagine coming into a room with a difficult leadership issue, and when this process of deliberation works with people from different views, you leave the room saying, man, I still feel like we should go to the left, but I know now, that we need to go straight and we need to go to the right. I think it's an honest way to deal with these issues, and I think one of the it's the rare person. I don't want to go there. I think that is one of the examples that or one of the disciplines that's learned almost too late in leadership, and that's why you have boards of trustees. It's why you have advisors. And if we're wise, we populate those advisor bodies with people who we know will have different instincts than our own.
Very good. Brave soul to answer the question.
With brave.
With so much going on in the world around us and in the Metro Atlanta area, what are maybe some challenges or opportunities that you see this relationship between Emory and the Carter Center being so well positioned to be able to take on, whether it is a local challenge or a global challenge that maybe we aren't addressing right now?
I'm sorry, start that question again. Given what now?
Given everything that's going on in Metro Atlanta and worldwide, where do you see what challenges or opportunities, if you'd like to see it that way, would you like to see this collaboration between the Carter Center and Emory take on? It's a unique partnership that I would imagine is poised to take on some interesting things and has. Are there opportunities out there that are still yet to be?
Oh, of course.
You know, if this meeting was held after the results of the 2016 election I held, I'm sure we could think of many.
I didn't want to go there.
Well, I didn't either. Well,
too late.
You know, I think we need to be as flexible as we were in the past when we didn't abandon our international programs, but we concentrated a lot of my time that I had been spending in the classroom and so forth on people just in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And we had over 300 other cities who sent delegations here, a large delegation, sometimes an entire busload, to see what was going on. So we finally had the America Project, to use the same acronym, same mm-hmm. initials, TAP, the Atlanta Project, and then the America Project. And we even had a delegation come over from Great Britain. In fact, I went over and spoke to a large number of people in Great Britain who wanted to do the same thing for that towns over there. And so this idea that we had at the Atlanta Project now more than 10, 15 years ago has spread all over the world. And people are concentrating on how do we deal with the most poor people and deprived people and inarticulate people in our community who are basically abandoned. And so I think now that the difference in relative standing socially and economically between the very poor people on the one hand and the middle class who are going downward and the upper class is becoming a very serious problem. And that may be one generic problem in the future in which Emory and the Carter Center could cooperate.
I agree. I want to voice a caution that part of the Carter Center's success has been its focus. You guys talk about diseases, et cetera. There have really been only there have been five that the Carter Center has. Well, you added malaria, right? Yeah. Added six. I think it's important that the Carter Center and Emory consider the whole breadth of possibilities in the confines of those, as you say, the voiceless stewardship toward the voiceless. Mm-hmm. But I would suspect we'd want to be very focused on the few that we address. The interest is success in making a difference, not just making a statement of these are all the things that we think are important. For years and years, the Carter Center was not engaged in malaria. Malaria is hugely important, okay? And later on, getting involved, what, about 5 years ago, 6 years mm-hmm. ago, something like that? I can't recall exactly. But if we had gotten involved very, very early, would the same level of progress been made in trachoma or in a guinea worm? Perhaps so, but perhaps not at the same pace. I think focus is pretty important.
And the Carter Center's program determined is to stay focused. But, you know, the focus can be shifted.
And yeah.
I understood the question to be, supposing a domestic or international emergency or crisis or very important issue should arise, I think in that case we need to be flexible enough to mm-hmm. to
this
join.
This may be a good place to talk about the Ebola example in Liberia yeah. because the flexibility, why the Carter Center was so, the reason the Carter Center was so effective in Liberia in helping with Ebola is not because there was an Ebola agenda. It's because the networks that had been formed and the trust that had been established.
Yeah, we had worked for years, for instance, getting village chiefs on board our program to enhance the law enforcement in the country. Before we started, there were two different sets of laws. One was national law, which nobody paid much attention to, and the other was the local village laws that were administered by the chiefs. And they didn't condemn rape. A woman couldn't inherit property if her husband died. And women were precluded from filing any sort of claim in the judicial system for her basic rights. So we got all the chiefs together, about 4,000 of them in a way, and we began to work so that they could exchange ideas and also between themselves and the federal government. We had another program that Rosen started. After the 16 years of war in Liberia, there was only one psychiatrist in the nation, so Rosen decided that we needed to train nurses to be psychiatric nurses. So we've now trained over 160 of those. And then we had another program of access to information where we analyzed which people within the country had information about their own government's activities. So those three programs were ongoing when Ebola broke out, so it was natural for us to be called upon by the government of Liberia and also by the World Health Organization and CDC to put our three programs together. So it was a built-in program. And so that's the kind of thing that we quite often run across. And it's just a fortuitous thing that we were able to do that. Mm-hmm. But Jim's right, we didn't plan to go in and address Ebola. Mm-hmm.
Well, we've come to practically the end of our time. I would like to ask if, in closing or concluding remarks, if you'd like to make a closing statement to our audience okay. as we wrap up this evening. Feel free.
Well, I want to thank the audience for being so constructive and helpful both to the Carter Center and to Emory. There's no way for you to help one without helping the other. I hope you've gotten that across tonight. Even if you want to help just Emory, you can't, because if you help Emory, you help the Carter Center. So we benefit from all of your generosity, and we hope that you will look upon this brief description of the past to give you an idea of the future, so that if you have an idea or proposal or suggestion that we might consider for our activities in the years to come, that you wouldn't hesitate to let us benefit from your knowledge and your experiences. So that's one thing that I thank you for your help. Continue to help us, but also help us with your advice and counsel so that we can do a better job in the future.
Dr. Laney,
Laney?
I just want to say that the association with President Carter and then the Carter Center was one of the great things of my life. And of course, it's been 20-something years since I was involved in it. But I look back upon it with great affection and fondness, and the what President Carter has stood for so resolutely and aimed for in terms of doing good in the world, a humanitarian impetus that is in his very DNA, is something that I've always applauded and admired, and I want to thank him for that association and successively for the wonderful work that Jim Wagner's been able to do as president of Emory with the Carter Center, and carrying on far beyond anything I ever dreamed of. So I'm looking at it from the standpoint of a seed that blossomed forth and somebody else planted and watered and so forth, and I'm just watching the increase, and it's marvelous, and I'm grateful for that.
Thank you, Jim. That's wonderful. I guess I've got to say something, right?
Yeah.
And folks, first of all, the thoughts that you both have expressed, I would echo in terms of the value of that relationship. But I just want to impress upon the group of your alumni here, Jim Laney spoke about seeds. Jim Laney and Jimmy Carter have been seeds that have shaped the ethos and the aspirations in many ways, the direction of the university. I don't know what Emory University would be without you two. It would not have the character. It would not have the drive to understand its role as a global citizen. And so for that, allow me on behalf of Emory and also personally to thank you both. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Gentlemen, thank you, Crystal, for your insight and your wisdom tonight. I'm personally honored as an alumna to have the opportunity to hear these stories. I don't know about all of you. I'm a morning person. I'd love to join you for breakfast. I mean, that sounds amazing. So thank you so much. I also want to recognize the staff tonight who's helped put this event together, the staff of the Alumni Association, especially Michelle Obester, Gary Hawk from the President's Office, and Steve Hockman from the Carter Center. I think we all agree this is a very special evening. We're very thankful to all of you. Also, I want to thank all of you members of the Emory community for spending your evening with us and for your ongoing support and involvement at Emory. So please do join us immediately following for the dessert reception in the Ivan Alvin Pavilion in the main foyer. And again, thank you so much for being here, and have a wonderful evening.